Well, actually, when I was browsing through the program of this conference, I did notice that our chairman was coming from New Zealand. And on this projection of the Earth, that means he comes from the very bottom to the very top of this picture, flying 20,000 kilometers. The object I will be talking about is less exotic than that. The object I will be talking about is only 5,000 kilometers away. Unfortunately, you cannot fly there because it's 5,000 kilometers under our feet. Whether you are in Belgium or in New Zealand, 5,000 kilometers in either direction, the inner core of the Earth. Now, I don't expect that many of you have a geophysics background. I have neither. I'm a physicist, a materials physicist. So let me start with some basic terminology to sketch what the problem is we are actually studying. Composition of the Earth, four major parts. There is the crust, the tiny hard shell on which we live. There is the mantle, which is viscous plastic rock. There is the outer core, which is liquid metal. And the inner core, which is solid metal. How do we know that? By seismological studies. And seismologists use a particular terminology. So when I will talk about S waves, I will mean transverse waves through a solid. P waves are longitudinal waves. So how do you use seismic waves to study this composition of the Earth? You have an earthquake at one point, and you have different seismological stations across the globe. In station one, you will see both S waves and P waves. In station two, you will see P waves, but you will not see S waves. Why not? Because a transversal wave cannot travel through a liquid. And there is this liquid outer core, so that blocks the S waves in that direction. So the fact that you see a shadow where there is no S wave present, no S wave detected, is an indication that you have a liquid core. And people can do all kinds of reasonings along this way to come to this four shell model. Now, the peculiar observation that will interest us today is the observation that in the solid inner core, waves travel 5% faster in north-south direction than in the equatorial plane. And this is a key observation that contains some information about the kind of material that is present there in the inner core. What is that material? Well, it's basically iron. 90% iron, some 9% nickel, and small quantities of some silicon, sulfur, and other elements. It's the same material where meteorites are made of. That's how we know that this is the material in the inner core. What's the crystal structure of that material? You are metallurgists, so you know the iron phase diagram, temperature versus pressure. So we have to look at the different phases in that phase diagram, the BCC phases, alpha and delta, the gamma phase, FCC, the epsilon phase, HCP, and the liquid phase. We superimpose the conditions of the Earth on this, and the inner core is on the pressure axis at some 350 gigapascal, and on the temperature axis at 5000 Kelvin. And if we can believe this phase diagram in that region, well, the inner core should be HCP, solid, crystalline. How can we get an idea about the speed of sound, a seismic wave in such a medium? The easiest approximation to get the order of magnitude is to consider an isotropic material. And you maybe have seen these expressions before. If you know the bulk modulus, the shear modulus, and the density of an isotropic material, you can have the speed of sound for transversal and longitudinal waves in that medium. So we have all the basic ingredients. Let's go to the method that we use, quantum simulations. Why quantum simulations? Well, you have here a material that you can never directly observe. and it's very hard to recreate in a lab. So if you try to model it, you have very few clues. So better start from the most basic theory that is available, quantum physics, and try to predict everything from there. I will not dwell on the technical details, just this single slide about the kind of workflow. You provide information about positions of the atoms to your model, this here symbolized by a molecule. You construct the Schrödinger equation for this model. You solve it, in our case, by density functional theory, and from there you predict the observable properties of this material. I interrupt for a short advertisement. We run an online course on these simulation methods for material science. I will give you the link in the end. So if you know students or colleagues who are interested in following this remotely, it's open to join. Back to our story. If we can predict by quantum physics the bulk modulus, the shear modulus, and the density of a material, then you can have already this isotropic speed of sound. And we can do that. It's actually very easy to give an indication of the amount of time it requires. On one modern core, you can run such a calculation. So it's something you let your laptop do overnight. Very easy. If the material is not isotropic, if it is crystalline, then it becomes a bit more difficult. Then you need more than just the elastic moduli. You need the full elastic tensor. If you can calculate these elastic constants for the crystal you want to study, then you can predict the speed of sound depending on direction. That takes more work, so 1,000 core days. It's not something your laptop can do. Your laptop could do it in, say, 1 year, but you need to turn to a larger computing system, but nothing exotic. Once you know these elastic constants, you feed them into the so-called Christoffel equation, and from the Christoffel equation you get the speed of sound in any direction relative to the crystal lattice. One of our group, Jan Jaken, has written a paper a few years ago about how to very efficiently get the speed of sound from the elastic constants. So let's make predictions for this. Let's take a single crystal in the core and let's see what the speed of sound is in different directions. And to put the symbols, so my angle theta will be the polar angle, the angle phi will be the angle in the equatorial plane. On this two-angle picture, I project a colored sphere, and the colors are such that white regions are directions in which the speed of sound is the same as for an isotropic material. Red regions are regions where the speed of sound is faster than in the isotropic material, and blue where it is slower than in the isotropic material. And the specific example here is for an FCC iron crystal. If we look at the most red point and subtract the most blue point, and divide by the reference value the white points, then you get a measure for the anisotropy of the speed of sound. And in the case of FCC iron, this expression leads to something like 15%. I will not keep reasoning on these spherical pictures. We will reduce them to something that can more easily be compared to experiments. And that we do in the following way. You unfold the sphere until you have a theta phi rectangle as is projected there. And now we project everything and average everything over the phi degree of freedom. Because in experiments it's most easy to have an equatorially averaged value. So we project everything over phi, so we have only a curve that depends on theta. And now we can get the same anisotropy measure, but now averaged over phi, the difference between the maximum and the minimum relative to the isotropic value. And to give a few numbers, in FCC, the unaveraged was 15.5, the averaged anisotropy is 8%. That's the kind of numbers we can expect. How does that look like in observation? I cannot say in experiment, because we have only one Earth, but we can observe our Earth. And this is what observations tell us. So as a function of theta, from 0 to 90 degrees, from pole to the equator, this is the observed anisotropy. We can now make our predictions for single crystals. So let's do that. Yeah, the experimental value is 5%. We can make our predictions for an HCP iron crystal and an FCC iron crystal, and these are the two curves you see there. And in particular, the HCP curve coincides quite nicely with the observed curve. So this is a strong argument that indeed the material in the inner core is hexagonal closed packed. That is not new. That was known already since 25 years. There is a famous paper in Science by Stixrud and Cohen, who say that the assumption that the inner core consists of nearly perfectly aligned grains of HCP crystals is consistent with these seismic observations. Good. Let's try to go beyond this. And this is the third part, which for several reasons I coined going wild. We start from this situation, experimental curve versus computed HCP curve. There is one thing I didn't tell about this picture, something I have hidden under the carpet so far, and that is that the DFT calculations are done at zero Kelvin. The experiments, the observations, are of course done at the pressure of the inner core, 350 gigapascal and 5000 kelvins. The calculations are done at that pressure. That's very easy in a calculation, but at zero Kelvin. Temperature is hard, the DFT. But we can do it. It takes a lot of computing time, 50,000 core days, to have a direction-dependent speed of sound for a given single crystal at any temperature you want. This is expensive, so we have done this only for two cases. I will show you two results, basically. And the first one is, let's take this HCP iron at 5000 Kelvin. What is the anisotropy curve? This one. It does not agree at all with the seismic observations. The agreement with the zero Kelvin result was because you neglected temperature. What to conclude from that? Is the material maybe not HCP at all in the inner core? Is there something else going on? We do not know. We can just test a few hypotheses. And one of the hypotheses we tested was, let's still adopt the overall HCP structure, but let's disturb that crystal somewhat by stacking folds. Let's introduce stacking folds into the single crystal. And for a metallurgical audience, I don't have to explain that an HCP crystal can be modeled as a repetition of two layers of closed packed atoms, AB, 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 and so on. FCC is three layers of closed packed planes, ABC, ABC. But you can generalize that. I have a periodicity of two or three. I could go to a periodicity of six. What can I do with six of these layers? And which stackings can I make with these? There are four symmetrically inequivalent possibilities. The HCP one, because AB, 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 you can fit into six layers. The FCC one, because ABC, ABC also fits into six layers. But there are two new ones, like ABA, BAC. So let's reason about these kind of stacking fold crystals. A few years ago, we enumerated exhaustively all possibilities up to a periodicity of 10 and studied these. So we will use now a subset of these, a representative subset. I can argue why we have chosen these ones. And these are the HCP and FCC crystals, these two new ones with six periodicity of 6 layers, and 2 examples from a periodicity of 9 layers. For all of them, at 0 Kelvin, but at 350 gigapascal, we calculate the direction dependence of the speed of sound. And if we order the crystals in this particular sequence, these are the anisotropy pictures that you get. And with some imagination, you see something like a continuous trend in there. What is this trend due to? Our hypothesis for this is that it is symmetry related. For each of these crystals, we can look at the point group, the crystallographic point group of that crystal. It's plot there on top. And point groups have relations, the group-subgroup relations. So you can rearrange this picture until the point groups are in their familiar group-subgroup relation. And what you see now is that HCP, the 6-beta structure, and FCC are the most symmetrical ones. And this 9Y crystal is the least symmetrical one. And the symmetry is even that low that you cannot break it any further. If you confine yourself to something that is a stacking of A, B, and C layers, you cannot get a lower symmetry than this one. So that 9Y structure is a good model for a random closed-packed crystal. So from now on, we will look at random closed-packed crystals, but modeled by this particular 9Y crystal. So we can calculate the anisotropy curve for that random closed-packed crystal at 0 Kelvin, and it looks like this. Not bad, but certainly not a fantastic agreement. Now we do the second expensive calculation, 5000 Kelvin for this random closed-packed crystal, and that's what it gives. In much better agreement with the observations. So the hypothesis that the material inside the inner core is a random closed-packed crystal that is oriented with the C-axis north-south is in agreement with these observations. I don't claim that that is what is really happening, but at least it is consistent with what we observe. So I can complete my picture from the isotropic approximation. We went to a single crystal, then we added temperature, we added stacking folds, we combined stacking folds and temperature, and that led to the curve you saw on the previous graph. Something we are still working on is to add now a bit of randomness in the orientation. Rather than having everything perfectly north-south aligned, how much randomness in orientation can we tolerate and still be in agreement with the observed anisotropy? So I can conclude. The title was Stacking Folds and Grain Orientation in the Earth's Inner Core. The more precise conclusion is that an hexagonal closed-packed single crystal of iron at inner core conditions is not consistent with what is observed in seismic experiments, in contrast to what the literature believed so far. However, a random closed-packed crystal is in agreement with these observations. I certainly must acknowledge the people who were essential in this work, Jan Jaken, who did all these heavy calculations, and I can guarantee that was a lot of work. He did that wonderfully. And Attilio Rivoldini and Tim van Holst from the Royal Observatory of Belgium, because we are no geophysicists, but they know a lot about the literature and the problems in that field. So they were our essential guides to steer us in a relevant direction. I leave you with this final slide. If you want to download the slides, you can go right now to that link. The talk is being recorded and I will put it on YouTube, but there are already several versions of this talk on YouTube, so it will not be on an open channel. But if you download these slides again in a few days, you will see there the link where that recording is. If you want to see a longer version of this talk, 45 minutes, then you can access it via that third link there. It's not openly available, but with the direct link you will get there. If you are interested in our online course, you have the address there. If you want to see other talks about topics we are working on, you can visit my YouTube channel. And with this, I'm ready to answer your questions.